So this was a testing slide to check the projector. But it's also more. How we are doing testing? It usually looks something like this. We write some code that does some things and then does some more things. We have some assertions there. And if all of our assertions, like assert true, pass and don't generate an error, then our test is correct. Now, of course, this is the story for everybody else. In Erlang, we have PIDs and processes, and we have concurrency, so our tests are also concurrent, which simply means that while we are doing this, there is another process which also does some things, and then does some more things, does another check, and it can also claim that everything looks okay on that part. Of course, the problem is that since we are in Erlang and we are concurrent, we are going to suffer from some issues that are not there in sequential testing. And for example, there might be the case that between these two processes, these two events are in some kind of dependency. Maybe one of them is sending a message that the other is receiving. Maybe one of them is writing something in a net table, or it's registering a process that the other wants to communicate with. So while this might go very well in our unit test, a slight change, like this one, where the events are ordered a little bit differently, and this now ordering between the write and the read, or the sending and the after timeout that we have is reversed. If things go like this, then the result might not be so okay. So when we are testing concurrent programs, we are actually have a different picture. We have tests that have a certain scheduling that gives us some correct results, and a different scheduling of the processes might lead us somewhere completely different. So maybe we are lucky, and all the interleavings are like this. This is a test, a very simple test from the Poolboy library. And these are, the red arrows are dependencies between events, and any way you schedule things, everything looks green. Actually, I'm silencing a lot of warnings there, and that's why everything looks green, but let's assume that everything is fine. How do we know that we are in this situation, and not in this situation, where one, the most common, any time that you run this test that I have on the screen right now, you will get the green interleaving, but if the Erlang scheduler preempts the process and does some other things, 5 out of 6 possible meaningful ways to schedule this program will get you into the red area. So what are we going to do? Unit tests are not enough. We will always be probably getting in the first interleaving. Random testing might be okay in situations like the second one, where a lot of errors lurk, but we have no guarantee that we have found out every bug or that we have found this specific little bug that we are witnessing once in a million. What are we going to do? Not call Ghostbusters, which is very appropriate since the Erlang movie this year has them, but use Conqueror. And use Conqueror into real code. So I am Stavros. I work in Uppsala University as part of the release project, and I'm developing Conqueror. If you have never heard about it, Conqueror is a tool for systematic testing, systematic concurrency testing. And its job is to run a test under all possible interleavings in such a way that it can detect mainly abnormal process exits and report anything that everything that has led up to it. The goal today is to show you a lot of things that Conqueror has to make it efficient and really easy to use. And to start with, let's discuss a little bit about a weird little thing that we recently achieved, which is called optimal dynamic partial order reduction. Now, systematic, the way I described it, might sound to you something like stupid. I mean, take every possible interleaving. That sounds too many, and this is exactly the case. If we were to assume that a process might be preempted at every point between doing an addition, between doing anything that is actually happening there, then, of course, the search space is huge, and we cannot possibly keep track of it. And actually, it's not only meaningless to... it doesn't even make sense to check interleavings between things that could race, but actually don't. Not all events that can happen in your execution are in a race. So why explore all these interleavings? So partial order techniques are developed to show that, to explore interleavings that are different. The way they do that is that they pick a random execution. Let's say that it's the first green execution that you saw before. And then they analyze the trace of events that has appeared there, figure out the dependencies between the events, and then schedule and explore additional interleavings as needed. So if there is a race somewhere, the technique will plan an additional interleaving that reverses this specific race. And in doing so, it will actually achieve to avoid equivalent interleavings. If something has been explored before, then it will not schedule it again. Dynamic partial order reduction methods do this at runtime. You could do some static analysis to figure out that these two processes, these two pieces of code probably run at different processes, and then there might be different interleavings, and then be completely hand-waving and theoretic and assume the worst, because that's what you have to do. Or you can be dynamic, go at runtime, pick actual data, see that this process is writing to this exact edge table that you some other process is reading from, and then schedule the reverse interleaving. How this happens? This is the first interleaving of three processes, the white, the blue, and the yellow. I have wiped out some instructions that are not relevant for the races in this program, and I have left out one write operation and two read operations. So if this is the first interleaving, a dynamic partial order, a tool that does systematic testing using dynamic partial order reduction, it will first detect that there is a race between the read from the blue process at step 5 and the write from the white process at step 3. So it will schedule another interleaving that starts like this, so that it does the read from process 5, from the blue process at step 4, and then the write happens. This being dynamic, the tool will let the code execute freely from there on. We don't know that after process, the blue process read something and not what the white process wrote will stop there. It might have other steps, it might have a different control flow, but we don't care. The tool will let the exploration continue, and then it will find out that there is another race now. There is a race between step 7 from the yellow process in the second interleaving and step 5. So it will plan and execute a third interleaving on demand based on actual data. Finally, with some smart calculation that figures this out, it will also run an interleaving here where the read, this read, happens before this write, and both happen before the read at step 4. Now, of course, seeing this might be a little bit weird, and you might wonder why the new interleaving didn't happen there. Actually, that's what every other partial order reduction method could do. The answer of why we start there and not higher on is in a paper that we presented at the Principles of Programming Language conference in January. And I will give you a short description about what this is about. So optimal dynamic partial order reduction, which is employed by Conqueror instead of the classic dynamic partial order reduction, has the additional benefit that it does not even start additional interleavings. So the best possible method could start an interleaving, figure out that, whoops, we are actually exploring exactly the same thing, hide it under the carpet, and assume that, yeah, we never did this. So even though classic dynamic partial order reduction techniques improved orders of magnitude over exhaustive exploration or similar techniques, optimal dynamic partial order reduction improves orders of magnitude over classic dynamic partial order reduction. Does it matter? Well, maybe it does. The exact same example that I showed you the readers. The number, the parameter there is how many threads are doing the reading. Can get you with the classic method on an exploration that takes 86 minutes, where with optimal, with our optimal technique, this is a minute and something. And this can get even worse if you have different examples with more dependencies, more interleavings possible. This takes a test that takes a day and an hour and shrinks it down to 30 minutes. Both of them are efficiently are essentially exploring the same interleavings. The classic DPOR will abort some of them. Optimal will never waste effort. And this actually reflects on real code as well. We run, for the evaluation, again, of this paper, we run these tools on Dialyzer and Zeproc and some tests from Poolboy, and we still managed to get some benefits. It's not so amazing as the other ones, but are still relevant. So to summarize why you want and why you care about dynamic partial load reduction, in exhaustive exploration techniques, not all events, not all pairs of events are racing, so not all interleavings are interesting. Conqueror will never even begin to explore equivalent interleavings because of the optimal technique. And all of this happens with trace analysis, the intelligent algorithm that we have developed, and dependency tracking, detecting which pairs of events on an Erlang program are racing. Now, another smaller thing on making the tool usable. As I showed you before, the search space looks like this. So Conqueror will probably, if it goes and does this kind of exploration, if it starts a second interleaving, it would have figured out that there is a race somewhere that needs to be split off at step three. So splitting off at step three means that steps one and two are, have happened in exactly the same way, and now we continue to three. But getting steps one and two to happen in exactly the same way is something that, in the worst case scenario, you need to track calls across libraries, you need to figure out all the events that have happened there. So if you want to really do this for real, all the operations that have led up to this event need to be traced. So in order to do that, I don't know if this is really visible, I hope it is. This is an Emacs buffer where you can see that there is a SAD call to Conqueror on the top, specifying the test, specifying what a few options, and then a huge list of everything that needs to be instrumented. Now, since you probably don't want to sit down and iterate over, I need to add this library, and you can see that you have to even add the compilation flags and everything. This is a really, really sad story if you are a developer. So instead of that, the current version of Conqueror has only the top line, which I should have separated a little bit better, but I will show it later. In a live demo, probably, where you just say that I want this test, it's in this module, the code is the Erlang path, anything that you can find in there, and some modules, some additional modules probably that you need, and then Conqueror will start exploring on its own, instrumenting all the code, following all the calls outside the main modules, doing everything, everything for you. So if you really need full instrumented code for something, it's really easy and fun, and I had a lot of fun developing this, to do it automatically, and yeah, you don't even need debug info. I'm thinking of removing debug info from Dialyzer even, if you have the sources around. And we can even instrument erlang.erl, which is something that might seem a little bit weird, but erlang.erl has some wrappers around calls that are not actually built-ins. So these go through there. We Conqueror just takes erlang.erl and instruments it and loads it and nothing breaks, and this is amazing. So more goodies that Conqueror does currently. Testing does not stop on the first crash, like in the initial versions, because this is Erlang after all. Sometimes we care about a process crashing and some other process getting noticed, getting notes about this and resuming. The instrumentation happens in a way that all race-prone built-ins are inspected, and you may get some messages that say that this is not currently supported, and if you do, please tell me, file an issue on GitHub, for example, and I will get there and implement this in front of anything else that I'm currently doing, because you want it. Standard input, standard output are captured, and there is a detailed handling of exits and messaging. A lot of errors might be triggered because a process crashed and some link messages were sent, some monitor messages were sent, the name is unregistered, between this kind of tracking. So if a process is exiting, in case you don't know your Erlang good enough, but I don't think that I'm the most qualified person in the room to speak about this, status of the process is set to exiting, the name is unregistered then timers, if you are using them and don't want to send messages to this process, are cancelled. Edge tables are given away or destroyed. Link signals are sent. Monitor messages are sent. All of this happened because a process exited. The previous version of Conqueror thought that all this happened in an instant. Conqueror currently follows this list step by step. If there is a possibility that some processes get a monitor message before some others, then this interleaving will be explored. Now, moving on, what I'm currently doing. Bounding. Not all interleavings are equally probable. It might be the case that if you are hunting a bug that you saw out in the wild, this bug is triggered with reasonably few changes, few interventions from the scheduler that took out a process and put some other in, and that's all. So, bounding aims to focus the search first on interleavings with simple scheduling. Classic DPOR techniques support something called preemption bounding, and you may have heard something about this from Kostis in previous talks, which is essentially bounding how many times a process can be preempted. I am currently testing some different idea, which has recently been evaluated to have a better potential, which is called delay bounding. This is already implemented. It breaks a little bit dynamic partial order, optimal dynamic partial order reduction, but it can let a test of a huge program finish quickly on some of the schedulings. Of course, if you want to verify and be sure that no bugs are there, this bound should be set to infinite. Conqueror is currently giving a lot of tips, which might be annoying, and if you think so, please tell me about it, because lots and lots of racing events can happen in your program. For example, every call to a Gen server passes through Gen, and all these have a default timeout. Conqueror is assuming that all these timeouts might be triggered, and then your process has to handle them. Also, exit signals are racing, if you think about it, with anything that affects the global state. If an exit signal can arrive at any point, then if we want to be exhaustive and we want to verify, we have to say that, yes, it can happen before writing in a net table happened, before a registration happened, and every other possible built-in. And also, sometimes, abnormal exits are acceptable. For example, if you are testing something that is under a supervisor, the supervisor might actually be allowed to send shutdown signals. So tips are a step towards the direction of getting user guidance during exploration, which can be really increase the efficiency when debugging. For example, why lots and lots and lots of racing events? Ooh, I'm getting more tweets on top of my presentation. Isn't it fun? The Erlang register built-in has the following few dependencies. Depends with send, because you might send to a register process and you want the send to happen before you send. Depends with unregister, if for some weird reason you're using unregister somewhere. It depends with a different register that might be on the same process or might have the same name. It depends with where is, it depends with process info, it depends with exit. You are probably not directly interested to all these races if you are handling a specific bug. So guiding this in some way might be worth, might be something that you need. Finally, under development is this little graph option, which can show you the interleavings. And if, for example, you get a test that produces some greens and some reds, then you can figure out easier where the problem lies instead of just seeing a huge log. This is under development. This is a .dot file currently being produced and rendered with GraphViz tools. And eventually, I hope that this will be something interactive that you will be able to track to see while doing the exploration so that you can see if a lot of errors happen here and not there, then probably this is where the bugs are. This is from a small test that I hope that I will do in a demo in a while. This is from the Pullboy library that you saw earlier. Things that are missing currently, and I'm trying to find ways to include them, is communication with system processes. Right now, Conqueror starts after the Erlang VM has started. So if you want to communicate with one of the system processes, it's not trivial how this process will interact with the process that are under Conqueror. So for example, if you have an application start in the beginning of the test, maybe you will consider replacing this with a supervisor, with starting the supervisor directly instead of relying to the application master to start things. Because if you try to communicate with application master, you will get a big no. Ports are a big discussion. So anything that does file manipulation is currently shaky, but will eventually get there, I hope. And some, as a fun exercise, I want at some point to be able to run Conqueror on Conqueror, but then I need a test, so probably we'll use Conqueror and add Infinitum, try to run the tool. So Conqueror currently has a website, not conqueror.com, how imaginative. If you are taking something out of this, is that Conqueror is a tool that aims to be usable and practical. So it's already efficient in the best way it can. It can narrow down the search for concurrency bugs. The source is out there. You can see it. You can send issues. You can tell me that this thing doesn't work. And you can always run Conqueror help in order to see a huge list of options and tweaks and knobs, more than I explained here today. How are we on time? OK. So let's try to see this thing live.
So you actually have about 20 minutes, Starbucks, so if you want to take questions as well.
Yeah. I have it in mind. Okay. Looks good. Anybody wants, raise hands if you think you need larger fonts or something. OK. So here I have my current master branch of Conqueror. Aha, now I'm killing something of the display. Let me close Windows behind. All right. So let's use this for the test and use this for Emacs. So this is a test that Kostis showed briefly last year in a big slide, where it has some process trying to register itself as a bank, succeeding to register itself as a bank, and then another process is a customer that tries to send it money. This is not probably the best way to write this code, but it demonstrates nicely the different interleavings, the different bugs, and anything that can happen in there. Another process tries to unregister it, which is a robber, and get the money instead. There is a process being called God that checks that somebody got the money. And anyway, this is a small program that you can you might want to run under Conqueror. So what you are going to do find the terminal. OK. So I have downloaded here Conqueror. I have run make, and it didn't crash. So I will do a Conqueror. And Conqueror will tell me that I need to specify which module contains my test. OK. Conqueror, my test is in a module called register again. And register again is not currently included in the code path, of course. So I will tell the tool that this is in tests, suites, basic source, register. No, it's not the basic, it's DPOR. And again, I get a complaint because the register again test 0 is not valid. What might be wrong? Ah, the test is called register again also, because that was on the dark ages when I thought the test should be named this way. T register again. And now Conqueror did some things. So it instrumented register again, because I gave it in the code path. It instrumented IOLib, because we prefer to not see PIDs and see something more high level. And I will show you exactly what I mean. Instrumented Erlang, because that's something that it does casually. And completed finding 6 interleavings. 5 of them were errors. Now, depending on your inclination, you might want to see them as the FN key is killing me, Andreas. Conqueror produced a Conqueror report, TXT, which tells you exactly which options it used for this interleaving. And then it starts producing erroneous interleavings messages. And here it says that in the first interleaving, process tried to do an unregister, which crashed with a bad arg reason. And this happened because it tried to P3, which is here. Let me highlight it. Try to unregister the process bank. Process bank was process P, and process P had exited. So when you try to unregister a process, and this process, the name, and this name is not in the process registry, the register gives a bad arg. Another interleaving crashed because you try to send a message to a process that was not around, and so on and so forth. And I will show you also the graph option. This produces a dot file. The name is provided by you. And then if things go right, this is the output file. This is exactly the graph that you saw before, generated right now. So you can see here, up close, that Conqueror figured out that there was, whoops, a race between a process doing an unregister here and a message being sent to that name. There was a race between a process exiting and an unregister happening with the name that this process had. You can see exactly the additional interleaving that was explored to reverse this particular race. You can see a series of interleavings that began trying to reverse the other race. More racing events that were detected here, and so on and so forth. This looks nice if you have the dot engine is enough if you have a small test like this. It looks a little bit horrible if you have a large case. So that's why I think the front end should change. So that's it. I hope I convinced you that it's easy to use, has a lot of soft cushions around. Thank you very much, and go to conqueror.com to get it and play with it.
So we still have time for questions, and I'd like you to take the mic if you want to ask a question, if you will.
This looks really interesting. Have you used this with sort of any continuous integration, Travis or Jenkins or anything, where you actually just integrate Conqueror tests into a CI cycle along with properties and unit tests, dialyzer, and other things?
So not really. Probably exhaustive testing for this kind of thing is not... I don't think that it's so useful as in a general project. I think that it's for selective. But in the end, it's just a script that returns 0 or 1 when there are these kind of things. And you can compare even the output if you feel secure that this will be always the same. Conqueror itself has continuous integration, of course. And the tests that are in there are rigorously tested that are remaining the same. And the number of interleavings is reducing, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah.
So you're instrumenting modules like IOLib and Erlang that are shared with other code running on the VM at the same time. Mm-hmm. How do you make that work?
Old code is perfectly fine for any other module to sit in. I am loading new code. I'm working in there. I have made a few cries, I think, on the Erlang mailing list of why I cannot update the code server itself to run a new version so that my instrumentation is just every time that you see Erlang load, take whatever is in there, beat it heavily so that it works with Conqueror and make everything work like that, but it doesn't. So the system processes, other things that are not below Conqueror running, are running old code. If some of them get into new code, they are not affected significantly. All the code is instrumented. They know nothing about it. I'm checking for things in the process dictionary, for example. Very nice little hacks that I can talk for hours, if you want. So that's not a problem. The rest of the system can stay on. You cannot reload things there, of course, but...
Anybody else? Great, thank you very
much. There's another question.
Sorry. Hold your applause.
So you were telling us that register races with message sending, for example. Mm-hmm. But I guess those kind of interferences between BIFs are things that you have worked out by thinking about it. Mm-hmm. Have you thought about an automated method for discovering such interference?
No, not really. That's a big... as Kostis, who is my advisor, is saying there, then we trust that these are the races because Stavros wrote them down. So the worst possible case scenario is that we trust the few things that are in there and assume that everything else is racing with everything else. The things that I have thought out are okay, and everything else races with everything. An automated way to figure out this kind of dependency would be very interesting if I could come up with it. But yeah, that's a thing that is subject to me, and I'm not the best person. I can test all these things, but if I miss something, what will happen? Somebody will have to come in and tell.
What about code loading itself? You could have a race condition with...
So
code loading, I would imagine.
Essentially, as I said, since some processes are lingering in old code, if I were to load code again, first of all, code loader itself cannot be upgraded in any way that I have figured out. I made my cry in the Erlang mailing list. Nobody replied. I assume that this is a lost cause. If your test relies on code being properly reloaded, then we have to talk about it in the current state of affairs. So, yeah. I want to do this. I want to do even that. But I need support from the Erlang VM, from the OTP distribution. Yeah. Moment. Microphone.
So did you run any tests on any of like the libraries in the OTP, for example, Nisia or anything like that?
So far, we are... Yes.
And did you find any bugs?
Exactly. If there were any bugs that we would have found, they would have been on one slide or other. Kostis has found a bug on calls to a Gen server. If you want to stop a Gen server and restart it immediately, then the process might not have properly exited and the name is already occupied. So I don't consider this a huge success. So if you have a Gen server that is registered, by the time that you send a stop request to it and the time that the server actually exits and unregisters its name, there might be an interleaving there where you're restarting it will crash. This is the best we have found inside OTP and trying tests around there. If we find something bigger than that, we will make a huge fuss about it, so you will know immediately. Other questions?
We have a few minutes for a couple more questions, if you have them.
You can spend the rest of the session trying Conqueror yourself. You can see that you can do it in 2 seconds.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.